We celebrate today the eighth day of Christmas. Of course, our journey of the 12 days of Christmas will lead us to, of course, the celebration of the Feast of the Epiphany on January the 6th. But today is the eighth day of Christmas, and of course, it is a holy day of obligation. We are here for one reason, because of the eighth day. And it's not because there's eight maids a-milking, because it's 8 days after Christmas. Today is the feast of our Lord's circumcision. Every Jewish boy on his eighth day was circumcised according to the law. And yet, today's feast day is not titled the circumcision of the Lord. However, at one point it was. The feast day today is known as the Solemnity of Mary, the Mother of God. Last night, when I was getting ready for one of the anticipation masses, one of the altar boys noticed that Deacon Bob and Father Eric Bolick, who is with us today from the Diocese of Peoria, finishing his vacation in Yorkville today, and Dover, of course. One of the altar boys said, "Father, what's up with the blue on the vestments?" And I was like, "Well, my homily will point that out. Today is the Solemnity of Mary, Mother of God. But it is also the circumcision of our Lord. So I hope in my brief homily to make the connection between the two. So let's start off with the eighth day being the day of the circumcision of our Lord Jesus Christ, who was by his parents either circumcised or they brought in someone from the local synagogue or the temple. Bethlehem was only 5 miles away from the temple in Jerusalem. So why? Well, in the book of Genesis, the first book in the Bible, in chapter 18, we read the story of Abram. Abram, whose name will become Abraham. Abraham is wandering through the desert. He's an elderly man. He's most likely in his 80s or so. He and his wife Sarah have no children whatsoever. And God manifests himself to Abram. And he says, "Abram, you have no children, but I'm going to change your name from Abram to Abraham, which means the father of many nations. I will give you more children, Abram, than there are stars in the sky. And I have a piece of property in the Holy Land that I'm going to give you. It'll be your property. So I'm going to give you kids, Abraham. I'm going to give you land, and I'm going to promise you my faithfulness." Abraham's like, "This is a great deal. I get kids, I get property, I get the faithfulness and the protection of God." So Abraham's like, "Well, what do I have to do?" And God says, two things. Be faithful to me and circumcise yourself, all of your relatives and kinsfolk, and every child born to you and all your kinsfolk on the eighth day. Abraham's like, "Sounds odd, but sure." Now, I would just tell you, this is one of the real miracles of Judaism. Now, gentlemen, let's just imagine that you are a relative of Abram. And at the dinner table that night, this is an 80-year-old man. He's like, "Hey, so I was out in the desert today, and God appeared to me. And so I have this knife, and after dinner, we're gonna head around outside behind the tent." I'm just gonna tell you, that's a miracle. But the Bible makes it very clear that Abraham went home and circumcised every single one of his relatives. And ever since then, on the eighth day of every Jewish boy's life, the child is named and circumcised. That's what Jews do. If you're not Jewish and you're a man and you want to become a Jew, you have to be circumcised as a man. You can't be a Jew unless you're circumcised. Few reasons why. Although Eve, of course a woman, the symbol of all of humanity, ate from the fruit, it is the man who is considered to pass on original sin, not the woman. And thus the man is circumcised because he is the headship of humanity. So the man is circumcised, not the woman. So ladies, if you ever want to kind of Give one to your husband. You can remind him that he's in charge of original sin in our world, and not you. He passed it on. It's not your fault. So he's circumcised because he's the one who passes on original sin. The reason that his part of his flesh is removed is that the Jews believe that this is how original sin is ultimately removed from the human race, is by circumcision. The cutting away of sin is actually the removal of original sin. What sacrament do we have that removes original sin and makes one a part of God's people? Baptism. Okay? So for the Jews, circumcision is, in many ways, their baptism, in an analogy. And of course, the other great reason that they practice circumcision is because it was the shedding of blood. In every single covenant in the Old Testament, the covenant is sealed in blood. Whether it's the covenant with Noah, with Abraham, Moses, Isaac. And of course, the greatest of all the covenants, the fulfillment of all of these, is Jesus Christ, who establishes the new and everlasting covenant in the shedding of his own blood. So there's a brief tour of Jewish circumcision. So now let's ask the question, well, why was Jesus circumcised? And what does that have to do with today, on the eighth day, the solemnity of Mary, the Mother of God? St. Thomas Aquinas, one of the great doctors of the church, one of the most amazing theologians that the church has, gives seven very simple reasons of why Jesus was circumcised. And the first one has everything to do with our feast day today. The first one says this in the Summa Theologica. First, to show the reality of Jesus' human flesh against those who did not believe. So we're going to pause in his argument right here. The early church is really the history of the definition of who Jesus is. In the early church, there were a lot of bishops and priests and lay people who misunderstood who Jesus was. They either thought that he was just God, or they thought that he was just a man, or they somehow got that mixed up in between. And the definition that we have from the Council of Nicaea and the Council of Ephesus and the Council of Chalcedon, which were councils of bishops coming together and defining who Christ was and who the Trinity was, we often just take for granted. So Thomas Aquinas goes through here real quickly and mentions three people who got it wrong. To show the reality of his human flesh against Manichae, who taught that Jesus had a body, which was merely an appearance, against Apollinarius, who said that the body of Christ was consubstantial with his divinity, and against Valentius, who taught that Christ brought his body down from heaven. So the first reason why Jesus is circumcised is to literally say, he is fully human. Ghosts don't bleed. Spirits don't bleed. Visions don't bleed. Human bodies do. And where did his human body come from? Well, at the Council of Ephesus, it was declared by the church fathers, by the bishops, that Mary was Theotokos, Theo meaning God, Tokos meaning bearer, that Mary was the God-bearer. Mary was the mother of God. That is what the Council of Ephesus declared, and thus we celebrate today the Feast of the Mother of God, because Jesus could be circumcised, because Jesus did shed blood for the first time in his life. We believe that the eighth day, his circumcision was the first time that it was fully, completely proven that this child is not just a manifestation of the Son of God, but that he truly is the Son of God and the Son of Mary. Fully human, fully alive, able to suffer, and to be one with his people. Second reason that Thomas Aquinas mentions that Jesus is circumcised is this: to show the approval of circumcision, which God of old had instituted. So Jesus' circumcision is ultimately saying, circumcision in the Old Testament, this is how God established his relationship with his people. Ultimately, Jesus will fulfill this. For those of you who don't know, read the Acts of the Apostles or Paul's letters. Circumcision is no longer required. Christians do not have to circumcise their children. When Nurse Nancy walks into your room on the day of your son's birth, you can say, we're Christian. We're not Jewish. Don't circumcise the lad. Jews practice circumcision. Christians don't. Now, if we do, There's nothing against our religion if you choose to. But circumcision is not part of the Christian faith. Very, very clear in sacred scripture. Third reason why Thomas Aquinas says that circumcision of the Christ child was important. To prove that he was of the stock of Abraham, who received the command about circumcision, as a sign of the faith which he had in Christ. We believe that Abraham, ultimately unknowingly, by forming a covenant with God, prefigured, foreshadowed the covenant of Christ. And thus, Jesus, by his circumcision, ultimately is partaking in the covenant of Abraham, calling himself a son of Abraham, ultimately also the son of David, that Jesus is putting himself in relationship with the chosen people. Let's not forget, Jesus was a faithful Jew. Jesus was a faithful Jew. And in fact, I always like to make this very clear. If the Jews had accepted Jesus, we would still be called Jews. What is the reason why we are called Christians? Because the Jews didn't convert. We could have just been the chosen people. But we can't call ourselves that because at some point we had to separate ourselves from those who didn't accept Jesus. Jesus, as we know, is the fulfillment of every prophecy in the Old Testament. Jesus naturally comes out of the Old Testament. He doesn't destroy the Old Testament. He doesn't reject the Old Testament. He naturally comes out of it and fulfills all of it. He is Judaism in its fullness, and that's what we believe. And so Jesus ultimately fulfills the prescriptions of the old law to ultimately also fulfill them. Number four, and this has exactly with what I just said. Thomas Aquinas says, the fourth reason that the Christ child is circumcised is to deprive the Jews of a pretext for not receiving him had he been uncircumcised. If Jesus, because he's the Son of God, is like, well, I don't have to be circumcised. I'm not bound by the law. My Father and I gave you the law. I don't need to abide by the law. If that was the response of Mary or Joseph or Jesus, then the Jews could have easily rejected Jesus. So Jesus being circumcised actually gives the Jews absolutely no reason to reject him. Because he was a faithful Jew. Continuing. Number five. To commend the virtue of obedience to us by his example. And so he was circumcised on the eighth day as was prescribed by the old law. Obedience is key. My homily last weekend. We are called to be obedient people to those who have headship over us. Well, if you're a child, you're called to be obedient to your parents. If you're an employee, you're called to be obedient to your employer. If we are a son of God, or a daughter of God, or a child of God, we are called to be obedient to God. Sixth reason why Jesus was circumcised. That he who had come in the likeness of sinful flesh should not spurn the customary remedy by which sinful flesh had been cleansed. As we mentioned earlier, circumcision was how original sin was removed in the belief of the Jewish Old Testament. So Jesus is not going to reject that, but he's ultimately going to fulfill it. How, as we mentioned earlier, how do we as Christians fulfill the commandment for the removal of original sin and for one to be made part of God's covenantal people? But through baptism. And the great thing about baptism is baptism was not just for men. Baptism was for all people, male and female. And I think this is very important. Mary and Joseph circumcised Jesus on the eighth day. There's this new trend that we have among many young parents. I don't really want to baptize Johnny. You know, I want Johnny to really make his own decision about faith. When he's older and mature, he'll just be able to, like, you know, I just don't want to impose my beliefs upon him. Did Mary and Joseph impose their beliefs upon Jesus? Do Jewish parents impose their beliefs upon a child on the eighth day? They do. And thanks be to God, they do. I always kind of make a joke that, like, If Jewish parents were like, we aren't going to circumcise Isaiah because, you know, we just really think Isaiah should make his own choice. If every Jewish parent did that, in one generation, there would be no Jews. Because I'm just going to tell you, if you wait until Isaiah is 13 or 14 years old, there's no way you're going to get a knife by him. Let's be honest about this. So what do good, faithful Jewish parents say? They say, no, I'm not asking my child whether they want to be a part of God's family. I'm not asking my child if they want the inheritance. I'm not asking my child if they want the glory of the kingdom of God. No, I give that to my child because the greatest thing that I can give to them is my faith. I don't ask them. I give it to them. Just like I don't ask them what language they want to speak. I don't ask them if they want to eat their vegetables. I don't ask them what time they want to go to bed. I don't ask them what school they want to go to. I don't ask if they want to study. No, I impose that upon them because it's good for them. So I impose my faith upon them because it's the best thing for them. The same is true with baptism. We shouldn't wait until our children are of some age where they can magically choose to live a faith that we haven't raised them in. We presume that we have the best thing in the world and we want to give it to them. That's our ancestry in Judaism because baptism is the fulfillment of circumcision. And thus we do impose upon our children because we impose a lot on our children. And thanks be to God, we do. The seventh and last reason that Thomas Aquinas says that Jesus was circumcised was this: to take the burden of the law upon himself so as to liberate others, us, you and me, from the burden of the law. So on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, when you came to Holy Mass, I gave a greeting to those who do not join us every Sunday. And you might recall that in that greeting, I said, we as the parishioners of All Saints Parish are not a group of people who are obsessed with fulfilling laws. Because that is the opposite of Christianity. But however, that's how we're often perceived. Christians are just concerned with fulfilling laws and feeling good about themselves because they go to church on Sunday, but they're still really big sinners and they're not really not good people and they just make me feel guilty all the time because I don't do what they do. That's not Christianity. Christianity is not about fulfilling laws. Christ did not come to give us more laws and to have us fulfill laws. Christ came to set us free from laws. How does he do that? By giving us the grace and the ability to overcome the law, so that we're no longer burdened by it. We don't need the law, thou shalt not kill, if we love. A husband or a wife does not need the law, do not commit adultery, if they love. We don't need the law, don't take God's name in vain, if you love God. You don't need the law, keep holy the Sabbath, if you love God. You don't need the law, honor your father and mother, if you love your parents. Christ came to give us love and grace and mercy and the sacraments so that we could overcome the law and not be burdened by it. The whole point of Christianity is not to fulfill laws. The grace of Christianity is to be above the law and to live it in freedom, because that's what Christ came to do. And thus Christ takes the law upon himself and will ultimately crucify it, and in doing so give us the grace to live in freedom. That's the beauty of the New Testament. That's the beauty of the New Covenant. Many people on New Year's Day make New Year's resolutions. I think I always make a New Year's resolution. I normally never make it on New Year's Day because I need time to think about these things, and I haven't thought about it until today. So if you haven't made a New Year's resolution yet, that's completely fine. You can wait until, sometime this week. But I want to challenge you as your pastor to look at your life and say, where do I find Christianity to be a burden? In my relationships with my family, my husband, my wife, my children, my relatives, where do I find there to be a burden in the relationship? And then to allow the Lord to give you a New Year's resolution that will open your heart to love all the more. Because that's what God really wants. If you want to go on a diet for the new year, that's fantastic. You want to exercise for the new year, that's great. You want to read 10 books this year, fabulous. But God wants you to love more. And Christ's circumcision in the flesh, because he was born of Mary and was true man, born of a true woman, he was circumcised to set us free from the law. He was circumcised to liberate us from the prescriptions of the law. And thus, wherever we found bound by the law and to find the law to be a burden, we are called to be set free. May this upcoming year, 2016, give us the grace to be liberated and set free, that we may know all the more of Christ's grace, and that he who was born of Mary may guide us in this new year to be people of freedom and people of joy.